accept the Lord Jesus Christ, your Savior. I want that above all things. That's worth 100,000 programs like the one you've just seen. It's worth anybody's ministry just to see you get saved. God help you. Trust Jesus Christ today as your Savior and believe on Him and get eternal life and get it now. And know you have it by the grace of God.
And I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, "Come and see." And I saw, and behold, a white horse.
There's a man going round taking names, and he decides who to free and who to blame. Everybody won't be treated all the same. There'll be a golden ladder reaching down when the man comes around.
Okay, guys, this is Dan and Jason back with the Sons of Thunder podcast. This is episode number 3. Today, our topic we decided to do is rightly dividing the word of truth, which comes from 2 Timothy 2:15. We should probably read the verse, huh?
Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
Do you want to do it?
Sure.
You got it up? Go ahead.
Okay, so 2 Timothy 2, verse 15. "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth."
Right. So the one thing about that verse I'd like to start with, it's the one verse in the entire Bible that tells you what to do, study, why, to show thyself approved unto God, and how you do that,
rightly dividing
the word of truth.
Sure.
Jason, can you actually just keep reading?
Yeah.
Go 16, 17, and 18. This is the verses immediately after.
Okay, so starting with verse 16, "But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness. And their word will eat as it doth a canker, of whom is..."
I know, Hymenaeus
and Philetus.
Yeah, something like that.
You want me to keep going?
Yeah, one more.
"Who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some."
So the key there, the reason I wanted you to keep going, was verse 18 at the end there. It says, "overthrow the faith of some." So what God's telling us to do here is study to show thyself approved unto God, you know, rightly dividing the word of truth, blah, blah, blah. And if you don't, what can happen is you end up overthrowing the faith of some. So I guess where I kind of wanted to go with that, if you don't mind, I can just kind of talk about kind of examples of that. In the Bible, it tells you to rightly divide the word of truth. So you have, what that's mainly talking about, and, you know, pop in whenever you want here, is you have the nation of Israel that were given laws. Do this, do that. Here's what's going to happen with the kingdom. Jesus comes back, or the Messiah. They, you know, current Jews wouldn't claim it's Jesus, but anyways, we know that it is. Then you have this church age doctrine where the Jews rejected Jesus Christ. And now we have this age of grace in where you're just saved by the blood. We're not sacrificing bulls and pouring the blood on the altar at the tabernacle or the temple or whatever. So there's some weird...
Well, really quick.
Go ahead.
I guess to be very basic with some of our listeners, if you're just kind of getting into the Bible, the real basic concept that we're going to dive really deep into here is... all of the Bible is written for us to read.
Correct.
But only some of the Bible is written for us to follow.
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So just keep that in mind when you're reading the Bible that, you know, you got to look at... we talked about it a little bit on the last episode, or maybe it was episode 1. You know, who's talking? Who are they speaking to? When are they speaking? You know, those things, you have to look at that when you're reading the Bible. So I just wanted to kind of... that's what we're talking about when we are talking about rightly dividing. Know what's written to you and know what's written for you just to read as, you know, historical and, yeah. So,
right.
Anyway, go
for,
ahead.
For example, like in the Old Testament, you know, in Leviticus, Deuteronomy, Numbers, all that stuff. It will tell you what to do if you were to sin a certain sin.
Right.
You know, bring a turtle dove, bring a goat, a sheep, whatever it might be. And on the New Testament, we don't have to do that because we're just supposed to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and his blood sacrifice for remission of sins. So that's an example of rightly dividing the word of truth. That's a very basic one, right? So you go to the Bible and you read in there and it says, hey, you know, oh, if you sin this sin, oh, you're supposed to sacrifice two turtle doves. No. That's written for us to read, but we're not supposed to do that. We're supposed to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and he comes in and he fulfills the law.
Right.
So we don't do those things. So that's kind of a really basic way of looking at that. But what people do, and pastors these college professors and seminary professors, they don't rightly divide the word of truth within the New Testament itself.
Right.
Because actually within the New Testament itself, there are some apparent contradictions. One thing I think Jason and I would like to make clear with everybody out there, you know, you'll hear people say, well, the Bible contradicts itself. No, it never, ever, ever will contradict itself.
Not once.
As long as you rightly divide the word of truth and don't overthrow the faith of some,
like
from the beginning. For example, you know, in the New Testament, how are we saved? By grace.
By grace, yeah.
You know,
but you can't be saved by grace in the Old Testament because Jesus hasn't died yet.
Correct.
Right?
And the just shall live by faith, you know, and faith and the grace go together, and that's just not... It's kind of like a faith and work system is how a couple preachers like to say how it works, and I kind of like that too, because you have to have, like, Noah, for example, it was faith and works.
Yep.
Because he's Old Testament, right? Noah had to believe what God said, have faith in what God said, and he had to build an ark to get saved.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
So he actually, Noah represents the tribulation Jew, what the Jews will have to do in the tribulation after
the rapture
of the church. All of a sudden, this Old Testament type stuff comes back into play. You have to believe God, and in this sense, they'll know that it's Jesus Christ. They'll have to, you know, receive him as their Savior, but that whole eternal security thing is gone. You're going to have to do this faith and work system. That's another podcast in itself.
Yep.
Enoch, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say that the point, though, is God deals with different, as we call them, dispensations, but different, you know, time periods. He deals with people differently because... And it's as simple as I just laid out. In the Old Testament, prior to Jesus even ever coming to earth, you can't be saved by grace because that came after the blood of Jesus, right?
Mm-hmm.
So those time periods are different. God treats these people differently.
Yeah, did he deal with his people before the blood atonement that Jesus made? He had to deal with them some way.
Right.
Right?
Right. So and now, praise God, after, you know, Jesus Christ came to earth, you know, shed his blood, died for our sins. Now we're saying, I mean, it's much easier, right? But the point that I'm trying to drive home is he definitely dealt with people and deals with people differently across different dispensations. So when you're reading Old Testament passages about the, you know, those people and how they're, you know, what they need to do, you know, you look at Leviticus and some of these, you know, these laws that they had to follow, those are not written to us. They are not directed at us. We do not need to do those things because we're saved in a different way.
Correct.
So, anyway, keep going.
Yeah.
Sorry.
So, and the other thing is where we get in trouble in the New Testament is people stop rightly dividing. Most people rightly divide what we're talking about, the Old Testament from the New Testament.
Right, that's real
basic
stuff.
Most people, you know, that's called, a lot of people call it dispensationalism. I know that certain pastors are really against dispensationalism, but everybody observes the dispensations of God with the Old and the New Testament.
Yep.
But what we get into, the problem comes in the New Testament where people aren't rightly dividing.
Sure.
Because people get it, for the most part, I hope, minus the Catholic Church, that, okay, we're saved by grace now.
Yep.
And the Old Testament was like this work system. You had to do all these things. Don't pick up sticks. There was a guy who got killed because he picked up sticks on the Sabbath.
Right.
So, in the New Testament, Paul, the Apostle Paul, was given, actually even says, the dispensation. We should actually maybe pull up the verse. Let me see here. Ephesians 3:2, I believe. Hopefully I got that right.
You want me to...
Go ahead.
Hang on a sec. Ephesians 3:2. If ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you word.
Right there, Paul's talking about the dispensation of the grace of God. That, now we know that Paul is the apostle to the Gentiles and the church.
Yep.
So he was given this dispensation of the grace of God, which was a mystery.
Yep.
It was the reason Jesus died on the cross. He revealed it to Paul. Okay, now I want you to basically start the church, long story short. So
right.
So Paul's giving us Romans through Philemon is where we find and we read about Jesus, his death on the cross, and what it meant. He died for sinners. Like, he took our place on the cross, and that's what it was all about. Because if you remember, the apostles, they didn't know why he was going to die. Jesus said, you know, the Son of Man must be, you know, must die, and, you know, 3 days later he'll rise again. They were like, what are you talking about? They didn't even know. It was a mystery. It was revealed to Paul. So there's that dispensation of grace. And so in the writings of Paul, we find Romans 3:28. There's just some guys, we're going to take a little bit of time here to go over some verses that just show and illustrate.
I can get it. I have it.
Go ahead and read 3:28.
Romans 3:28 says, therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law.
Okay. So you're justified by faith and not by the deeds of the law. You can't work your way to heaven.
Right.
Okay, so I'm going to read Romans 5:1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So there, we're justified by faith again. It's all about the grace, right?
Yep.
So what do you do when you get to James? Jason, why don't you go to James 2:17.
James.
And we're going to show an apparent contradiction here.
Even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone.
Okay, and how about, read 18 then.
James 2:18?
Yeah, the next verse.
Okay. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will shew thee my faith by my works.
So now all of a sudden they're talking about faith is...
And works.
Faith and works, and you're like, what's going on with that? And then moreover, when I go to James 2:24, it says, ye see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith alone.
Yep.
Or only, sorry. Now, what is that about? That's completely the opposite.
Well, and I've actually had people in the Catholic Church bring these verses up to me when we're talking about, you know, because I've asked people that are Catholics, you know, do you know where you're going when you die? Right? And they'll say, no, nobody knows. Mm-hmm. I've actually had them say that to me. And it's just so, I mean, it's heartbreaking. And then they'll try to use these verses from James saying that, oh, you know, it's not just your faith in the shed blood of Jesus Christ that's going to get you to heaven. You got to do
these works. Look at James. You got to do these works.
Look at James. It says it right here, right? Mm-hmm. I'm sure they Googled the verses and pulled them up, right?
Mm-hmm.
But, it's an apparent contradiction.
But
go ahead, keep going.
But let's figure out, like, what's going on here. Now, if you remember, go back to 2 Timothy 2:15. It talked about how if you don't rightly divide the word of truth, you'll overthrow the faith of some, right?
Mm-hmm.
So some Catholic priest shows this to somebody that was shown, you know, John 3:16, says, oh, yeah, I'm saved. Jesus saved me. And then this Catholic priest doesn't rightly divide the word of truth, gives him James 2:24. It says, ye see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. Then this person, you know, is going to become
second guessing,
says, oh my gosh, I got to be a Catholic, got to do the mass, I got to get confirmed, I got to get, you know, baptized in water, and all this nonsense starts happening. Where was I going with this?
Well, just about who's actually being spoken to in James, some context about being spoken to.
Good, yeah, let's take it that way.
Because it's an apparent contradiction,
mm-hmm.
unless you're rightly dividing.
Right.
And you know, and the way we're getting this, guys, by the way, we're not just like making it up, you know. This is for us, this is for other people, you know. Mm-hmm. The Bible tells you who's being spoken to.
Yeah, like, how, good point, Jason. How do we know that James 2:24 was not written to the church?
Right.
And in the church...
Fair question.
In the church, there's no Jew nor Gentile. We're all one in Christ Jesus.
Right.
So we know with of the church, we're all one body. God doesn't say, oh, you're a Jew Christian, you're a
right.
An English Christian, you're an American. No, it's just we're all Christians. But outside of the blood of Jesus Christ, there are Jews and Gentiles.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
So you can keep going if I think I know where you're going.
Well, no, I mean, I was going to, I guess I'm bouncing the question off of you.
Okay.
Like if I were listening to this as a beginning Christian, I would want to know, so how do you know who's being spoken to in James?
Okay, here's how we know that it's not written to the church. Now, if we go back to earlier in the podcast, the episode here, we were talking about how the Jews, the 12 tribes of Israel, mm-hmm. had laws.
Yep.
And these are things you had to do, works,
yep.
to be saved, right?
Yep.
All
yep.
that stuff, the Ten Commandments, blah, 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 yep. all of that. Well, if you read James 1:1, do you want to read it or do you want
yeah,
me to?
I'll pull it up, yeah.
Okay, read 1:1. James 1:1. This is who the book of James was written to.
James 1:1. James, a servant of God and of the Lord, Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting.
Okay.
So, there you have it. I mean, go ahead, keep going.
No, go ahead.
Well, it's talking to the 12 tribes of Israel.
It's not talking to the church.
The entire book of James, then, is speaking to the 12 tribes of Israel.
Correct. So, we know it's not the church because the church is never identified as Jews only in the 12 tribes of Israel.
Right.
Never.
Right.
Never. Paul was told to go to the Gentiles. And we could just like contrast that with, let's just go to, Paul, 1 Corinthians, for example. Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, and Sothenus, whatever, our brother, under the church of God, which is at Corinth. We'll stop there. Paul's writing to the church. It's right,
right
there. And then, guess what we find in every time Paul says, to the church? Because all of a sudden we find that you're saved by grace through faith.
Yep.
So that's where you get grace. And then what happens in James, the funny thing with James is, it's not, quote-unquote, an Old Testament book. But it really kind of reverts back to Old Testament. And that happens because Paul writes 13 books, Romans through Philemon, and
correct.
Probably most, if not all, of
Hebrews yeah.
right? Well, that's another thing. In Hebrews, you don't get the whole saved by grace through faith. So you got 13 books in a row, saved by grace, saved by grace, saved by grace. All of a sudden, you get to the book, the first book, after the book of Acts, where the... Jesus died on the cross in the Gospels, and then you have the Acts of the Apostles.
Yep.
It was basically the transitioning of the church, or I'm sorry, of Israel and all the laws, like, oh, Jesus died, over to the church, and now it's grace.
Yep.
And then you got Paul writing 13 books in a row about grace, and then it goes, the very next book and is what? Hebrews.
Hebrews, yeah.
Funny thing is, in Hebrews, it doesn't talk about, it's not a book that's all about grace through faith. Now,
right.
there's a lot of truths in all of these books that we should read. Be very serious about. But if there's a spot in Hebrews where it's not talking about saved by grace through faith, guess who it's written to?
It's written to the Jews.
Hebrews.
Yeah,
Hebrews.
Yeah. He is
not,
literally in the title.
Otherwise,
of the book,
it would
right?
say. Otherwise, it would say church. It's the title of the book. And then James, it's to the 12 tribes scattered abroad. That's funny how those two books, which are written to the Jews, start matching that Old Testament stuff again.
Right.
And that's what we're talking about.
Right.
And why does that happen? That's because the church gets raptured out of the way.
Yep.
Right? And then all of a sudden, God refocuses back on Israel. You can see that because Israel became a country again in 1948. This is all getting ready the rapture is near. We're going to be gone. All of a sudden, God's back to dealing with Israel. Jesus is going to come down, Armageddon. He's going to reign in
thousand-year millennial reign.
All that stuff. So when people don't rightly divide the word of truth, it's a mess. All of a sudden, people are doubting their salvation. They're looking in James. Why not just... People would rather go to hell or tell somebody they're going to hell by giving them a James verse than tell them they're going to heaven by giving them a Romans or Galatians
exactly.
or whatever.
Exactly. And, with the whole works thing, if you believe that you have to do something to get to heaven, I guess, how do you keep score, right? How do you know when you've done enough? How do you know... And if you can work your way to heaven, we've talked about this before, if you can work your way to heaven, when you get up there and you say, you know, if I ask you, hey, Dan, how'd you get up here, man? And you say, oh, it's a really good person. Did all kinds of really good stuff for the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And then Jesus Christ walks up with his wounds, right? And he says, well, I guess I didn't need to do this then. I don't know.
Right, if you could do it yourself.
Why did I even bother? Right. I mean, dying on the cross really sucked, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why I did that.
Right.
If you could have just been a good person and, mm-hmm. you know, that was really dumb.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, why did I do that?
Why did I do that?
Oh, you could have worked your way to heaven? Oh!
Oh, jeez.
What did I die on the cross?
Nobody told me.
You know, and there's another verse I want to go to, because going back, it talked about, you know, the verse was, you know, study to show thyself approved unto God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that goes on to say, rightly dividing the word of truth. Go to 1 Corinthians 11:19. Don't read it quite yet. Kind of want to give a little explanation here. This is something that I ran into recently. So what normally happens as far as, you know, getting these heresies is, you know, heresy is when you're just preaching something that's completely wrong. And most of the heresies happen when you have somebody taking James, saying you got to do works, and you're throwing it into the church age doctrine, overriding the death of Jesus on the cross, saying now we have to work, right?
Yep.
Okay.
So or some way of not rightly dividing. Right?
Some way of not rightly
that's
dividing.
It, yep. Yeah.
Some way of not rightly dividing. And the most common one is taking something that belongs in the tribulation and applying it to the church age right now.
Right.
So read first, hopefully I got it right, 1 Corinthians 11:19.
For there must be also heresies among you, that they which are approved may be made manifest among you.
That verse just really hit home with me because...
Approved.
Approved. Right. That was written to the church. That was written to the church because that's in Corinthians. Paul's writing that to us. And he said, heresies, which is getting doctrine all screwed up and putting it in the wrong places, how does it say it must be manifest? How does it say that?
Sorry, I went out of it. 11:19.
1 Corinthians 11:19, yeah.
For there must be also heresies among you, that they which are approved may be made manifest among you.
So God's almost saying, you know, these heresies, like these... Think about, like, a Catholic, for example,
mm-hmm.
or a Pentecostal person, a charismatic, where they're speaking in tongues, and even though tongues are a sign for Israel, kind of putting that in the wrong spot.
Yeah.
And you get all these different denominational churches because they're not rightly dividing the word of truth.
Correct.
So these heresies happen, so those that are approved, and remember, how do you get approved?
Rightly dividing.
Word of truth. Study. So that 1 Corinthians verse that we just read really backs up that rightly dividing verse, 2 Timothy 2:15.
Right.
And lets you, you link those two together, and then God's telling you to do is look for the people that are rightly dividing the word of truth. And just locally here in Minnesota, there's a guy on the radio, Les Feldick. He's really good. He talks about this, and he's fantastic with rightly dividing the word of truth. And of course, there's some world-renowned ones like Peter Ruckman,
the best ever, probably.
David Hoffman's fantastic. Doug Stauffer. So those are the
Lawson's
ones that are
good.
Approved because they have rightly divided the word of truth. And it's so nice when you start reading the Bible and you realize, wow, oh, why is it talking about works? And you realize, oh, it's written to the 12 tribes. Oh, it's Old Testament type stuff, basically. Oh, just stick with Paul as far as your salvation.
Follow Paul.
Yep. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't go to Hebrews and read stuff and say, oh, this isn't for me. No, it's all for us to read. And there are absolute truths in Hebrews, like the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword.
Right.
That's in Hebrews. That's true throughout all dispensations.
Well, and I like to point out 2 Timothy 3:16, right?
Okay.
Where it says, pull it up here, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. And is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
All scripture is given by inspiration of God. We talked about that a little bit in our last podcast about why we use the King James Bible. All scripture is given by inspiration. So everything's from God, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the key thing is who is it directed to? Is it, you know, are you reading your mail or are you reading someone else's mail?
Are you reading the 12 tribes of Israel's mail? Or are you reading your mail, the church's mail?
You can get educated by reading their mail,
Yeah.
But
and God wants you to read it.
And he wants
mail.
You to read it. It's there for a reason, but it's not for you to follow, you know, to get saved or anything like that. So that's the big thing, right?
Yep.
Really quick, and I kind of mentioned last time that we would probably bring this up on almost every podcast. I just wanted to talk really quick about, so 2 Timothy 2:15, almost the entire verse that we're basing this off of.
And as far as, you know, how faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God.
Mm-hmm.
So 2 Timothy 2:15, in my opinion, is one of the most important verses in the Bible and for the New Testament Christian, because when you're rightly dividing the word of God, and remember, the word of God gives you the faith, you know, faith cometh by hearing. It really, being able to put things where they belong and not get into any of these heresies, it really strengthens your faith.
Yep, so and you have answers. You know, always be ready with an answer. You have answers for the people that are not rightly dividing.
Right.
If you're able to rightly divide and you know what goes where and who's being spoken to, you have answers to some of those difficult questions where people are saying the Bible is contradicting itself when it's not. It's absolutely not. So what I wanted to read, though, really quick. So 2 Timothy 2:15 in the King James Bible says, "Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." Study to show thyself approved unto God. If you read it in an NIV Bible, New International Version Bible, 2 Timothy 2:15, "Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, who has correctly handled the word of truth."
What a mess.
What a mess.
What does that even mean?
Do your best to present yourself.
Okay, what should I do?
How?
Well, the King James said it's a study.
It says, correctly handle the word of truth.
Well, how do I handle the word of truth? Oh, wait, the King James tells us.
Carry it?
I
don't know. But do your best.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how you do your best or what you need to do, but do your best.
Yeah.
To present yourself.
Yeah, it's just watered down.
Do your best to present yourself. Does that mean like work out? Like physically get in shape to present yourself?
And I cannot stress how important that verse is.
Oh, it's huge. It's everything.
It gives you gets James, Hebrews, all this work stuff that seems to contradict what Paul wrote by grace. It lets you look at that and say, oh, wait a minute, I gotta divide this. This is not church. Why? Well, it doesn't say it's for the church.
Right.
You know, and that 2 Timothy 2:15 is kind of a roadmap for you in the New Testament.
Yep.
It is. Like, it gives you directions throughout the scripture. So, it gives what you gotta do.
Right. So, for the people that are listening, if you want to kind of, one book that's out there, I don't even know if it's out there really anymore, but Stauffer wrote the book about, One Book Rightly Divided.
Yeah, great book.
I have it. It's terrific. I actually kind of skimmed through it a little bit for maybe the third time last night as we were preparing for this, and I took a quick picture, and I wanted to... So if you're listening and you want to kind of create your own timeline and, you know, put things in their proper place, draw, you know, a line on a page, right? Draw... At the very beginning, have Genesis through Malachi, right? That's your Old Testament.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can draw a cross. That's when Jesus is, you know, on earth, and then death, burial, resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
Those are Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John,
mm-hmm.
right? And then Acts is kind of right after.
Yeah, Acts is that transition book from what Jesus did, you know, dealing with Israel, and now all of a sudden we're going to the church.
Right.
Acts is one of the
literally
most...
actions, right?
Yeah, right. Go ahead.
Well, and then one really quick, a little off topic, but the New Testament actually doesn't start right at the beginning of Matthew, right?
Right.
Because Jesus hasn't died yet.
Right.
When Jesus dies, and if you look at Hebrews chapter 9, verses 16 through 17, tells you what creates a New Testament. It's the death of a testator,
mm-hmm.
right? So,
yeah, it's like when somebody dies, their last will and testament.
Yeah, right.
It's like, exactly. When I die...
And I think it's Matthew 27 when Jesus actually dies.
Okay.
So that's when your New Testament is actually started, right there.
Mm-hmm.
So then we have Acts, and then we have the 2,000-year church age, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's Romans through Philemon. We talked about that.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have the rapture of the church, right? And then you have Hebrews... through Revelation, right?
Yeah, that's that tribulation
that's
stuff.
That's the tribulation stuff. Hebrews, James.
You get a glimpse of the church at the beginning of Revelation
the letters to the church. Yeah,
yeah, right. But
And so you have the tribulation and then the thousand-year millennial reign, and that's Revelation. But for those of you that are trying to follow this, I hope that was clear, that I was, you know, creating a chronological timeline there of what's being said, who's being spoken to, who it's directed at.
And hopefully now, you know, this is just a very brief look at something like that, but you can look at a verse that's troubling you, and maybe you'll realize, wow, that verse is troubling me. I bet you it's in James or Hebrews or one of the general epistles and like that, or Jude, that doesn't really, wow, this really kind of scares me, like I'm not saved, and it overthrows your faith, right? If somebody's teaching you to go to James to get some church-age doctrine, it isn't right. We should touch on this just a little bit. We could do a podcast on eternal security.
Yeah,
where once you're saved, you're always saved.
But we can touch on this, though.
Yeah. So one thing that happens when you get saved, when you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, what you're doing basically is you're saying, Jesus, I accept you as my Savior, and I am taking and trusting what you did on the cross to get me to heaven. And that's it. And then you're saved, okay? And in fact, I think it's 1 John 1:7 where it says the blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from all sin. Okay? So there. Let's just think about that. Jesus paid the price. Every sin is paid for right there. Yep. Right? Well, if you go to Revelation, or Jason, you can bring up Revelation 14:11. There's other verses too where it says once you're saved, you're always saved. It says you're sealed until the day of redemption.
Sure. What was that? I'm sorry. Revelation.
Go to Revelation 14:11. Here's another thing that a lot of churches get screwed up. They'll say, well, don't take the mark of the beast, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, what happens when you don't rightly divide, you'll go to something like Revelation 14:11.
It says, and the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name.
So right there, you've got, if you take the mark of the beast, you go to hell, right?
Right.
That's what you have.
Yep.
So I'm a saved Christian. Jason, you're a saved Christian.
I am.
So now it says, wow, if you take the mark of the beast, and there's more, that's just one quick verse, that says you go to hell. So we got people saying, don't take the mark of the beast, don't take the mark of the beast, which is great, don't take the mark of the beast. But is that really written to us? Because we're saved from, I thought Jesus' blood cleanses us from all sin. Right?
Right. So now, what happens if...
Yeah, and that's a sin.
Which one's more powerful than
the other? Which one's more powerful? It's blasphemous to say that the mark of the beast is more powerful than the blood of Jesus Christ.
Correct.
So what happens there is something changed. That's a work. Don't take the mark of the beast. That's not grace there.
And it's also another potential contradictory statement, right?
Like, yep.
Okay.
And God is not a man that he can lie.
Right. So, where's the...
What's going on here? We got to rightly divide because there's a rapture in there. And certain things are written to certain people. And other things are written to other people.
Right.
So right there, you know, we've got...
And I just mentioned the timeline.
Yep.
Right? I talked about who's being spoken to in Hebrews, James, Revelation. It's talking to people in the tribulation right there.
Yep.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Don't take the mark of the beast. Can't take the mark of the beast.
Mm-hmm.
We're not even... As in the body of Christ, in the church, we're not even there. We're not going to have the option to take the mark of the beast.
Right.
We're raptured out before.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's the only way it makes sense.
Otherwise, God lied, and he didn't cleanse us
from all sin.
And Jesus' blood isn't that powerful.
It doesn't say all sin except for that one.
Right. Right? And it also says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. It didn't say everlasting unless you take the mark of the beast.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yep.
There's some really basic stuff, and I know John is in the Gospels, but John had access to all the Pauline doctrine. That's why if you read the Gospels, which are Old Testament stuff, by the way, mm-hmm. you'll see Jesus talking about doing the law and all this stuff. The reason John is different is because John actually had access to all of Paul's grace gospel.
Yep.
So when John writes the book of John, the gospel, it's got kind of a feel of, well, yeah, this is, you know, to the Jews only, you know, because Jesus even went to the Jews only, not to the Gentiles.
Yep.
It says, go only unto the lost sheep of the house in Israel, not to the Gentiles.
Correct.
So, you know, hey, I'm a Gentile, by the way. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, I mean, Jesus didn't want them to come to me because that was still Old Testament stuff. But John has that feel of, you know, everlasting life and it's very different than the other Gospels, because John had access to Paul's epistles and his revelation. So when John's writing his Gospel, he knows about the grace of God. So you see that worked in there. It's kind of beautiful the way that worked out like that. And that's why John is the most beloved Gospel. You don't hear people like making movies on Luke so much. It's either, you know, it's on John or it's on all the Gospels as a whole, you know.
Yep.
But anyways, I mean, I don't know how far are we into this. We're a little past the half hour. We could probably wrap it up unless there's somewhere else you think you want
to go. No, that's kind of what I wanted to get at, I guess, is to kind of settle the issue of there's you know, people saying that there's contradictions in the Bible.
There are none.
If you believe that there are contradictions in the Bible, it's because you don't understand it, you don't know how to read it. I don't mean to sound mean there or
I used to not know how to read it.
Me neither. And I'm just being honest. I'm not trying to be mean. I'm just saying you don't understand it. You don't know how to read it. It's okay. You can learn. It's real easy to learn. You just got to pay attention to understand who's being spoken to, when it's being said, you know, who it's directed at. It's very, very simple and easy to do, but it's also very easy to get mixed up. Right.
Yep.
If you're not doing that, if you think everything's written to you, you're not building an ark out of gopher wood. Right, you're not putting the blood of a lamb on your door, right? You're not doing any of that stuff.
You're not eating unleavened bread for 7 days.
You're not abstaining from pork. You're not
observing every Sabbath, because Jesus fulfilled the law.
Right.
So whenever you got a verse that sounds like it's going outside of what Jesus did and it makes you uncomfortable, just remember about rightly dividing. Look to see who it was written to. Is that in James, where it was written to the 12 tribes? Is that in Hebrews, where the title of the book is Hebrews? Even though the church, there's no Jews nor Gentile. There's just, we're all one in Christ Jesus. Here's another verse in Titus 3:5 that Paul says, which is one of my favorite ones. Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. You got the most, I don't want to say righteous, but the best Christian who ever lived, Paul, the apostle, claiming that not by the works of righteousness, which we have done. He's claiming, hey, we've done it, but that's not saving us. He said, and it's by his mercy.
Right.
And dying on the cross and by his grace. So if you're not saved, rapture is near. I know people have been saying that forever. And they were always right, because it could be whenever.
Yeah.
It could be any day.
You should be watching for them. And we'll get called up into the clouds, right?
Yeah.
If you're not saved, if you don't know where you're going when you die, because someone's always told you that you got to do, you know, this, or this, you got to jump through these hoops, you got to, you know, whatever church you grew up in, if they preached anything other than just trusting the shed blood of Jesus Christ, that's... You don't have to do any of that stuff. You just have to trust and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. What he did on the cross, his shed blood, that's it. And you're in.
It's not about good or bad. It's about saved or lost. Your conscience will always bear witness to you that you're not doing enough to be holy, righteous, like God Almighty.
Hell is full of people with good intentions that thought they were good people, right?
That's correct.
It's full of them. And we'll do a podcast on that, too.
So if you're not saved, get saved. Time is short. Life is but a vapor here, and it vanishes away.
That's it.
I guess that's it.
Just believe it. Get saved. I mean, I can't. We keep saying it, but it's so important.
Don't worry if you're thinking to yourself, I can't live it. I'm too big of a sinner.
Join the club.
Oh,
right?
I just can't go to church. Fine, don't go to church. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved.
That's it.
It's the easiest thing in the world. I guess anywhere else you want to go?
No. Next topic I think we should do, we'll get into the topic of eternal security, I think.
Yeah,
that's kind of stems off of what we just talked about a little bit.
And guess what? We'll stick in the, with rightly dividing, we will, with the eternal security, we'll rightly divide and take all the verses given to the church age on why we are once saved, always saved.
There you go.
That'll be next topic.
So that'll be the next topic that we do. That's it. That's all we got. Thanks for listening, guys. God bless. If you're not saved, get saved.
Listen, when you get saved, it's not just getting something for nothing. It's getting everything for nothing. See, that's what the thing is.